tonight with the urgent search and rescue operation underway tonight after Hurricane Ida slammed into Louisiana, into New Orleans, one of the most powerful hurricanes ever to hit. Hurricane Ida making landfall near Port Fourchon, Louisiana, as an extremely dangerous Category 4 storm. With winds 150 miles per hour and those reported wind gusts reaching 172 miles per hour. And then remaining a Category 4 storm for an astonishing 6 hours, tearing through southeast Louisiana, ripping parts of the city of Lockport to shreds. In New Orleans, the new levees after Katrina did hold. That was reassuring, but the city's reinforced power grid did not. Tonight, more than a million customers across Louisiana are without power. And the utility now warning it could take weeks to restore. Tonight, the images of the Coast Guard, the helicopters taking off as soon as they could to try to assess the damage, out searching for people who stayed in their homes, reports some trapped in their attics for many hours, some waving to the Coast Guard above. Tonight, we know of at least 2 deaths. The governor saying tonight that we should be prepared for that number to rise.
Michael from the Cajun Navy offered to take us in.
This entire town is submerged. We're driving on the main street.
And there we saw a flotilla of small boats on the water carrying out the stranded and the exhausted. And it was on dry land that we met these two.
You guys didn't expect it would be this bad, did you?
We didn't expect it to be this bad. And we stayed because we were in a two-story home. And we thought we would have been safe. The rain just kept coming. It wouldn't stop coming. The rain wouldn't stop coming.
We pushed further into Laplace, seeing entire neighborhoods submerged. The stranded flagging down anyone with a boat.
Look where the line at. That's where the water was at.
Jackie and Denise Cooper's mother, Lucille, is disabled, and they asked me to help get her down the stairs.
You guys gonna come back?
No.
Do you think at any point that you might not make it?
Yeah.
Michael had gone back to get help. He needed more boats. Sure enough, within half an hour, he was back.
So I stayed here during Hurricane Ida. And by here, I mean Pearl River, Mississippi. My house sits on 5 acres of land, nothing fancy, just me here and my wife. After the storm, we ran our generators. It's hot as a dog's ass out here, but everything was going fine. It was a normal hurricane situation. And if you live in the southeastern portion of the United States, then you know life after a hurricane is uncomfortable, but it ain't the end of the world. As long as your house doesn't fall apart and you can generate some power, you can make it through it. Now, I believe the Dogman activity didn't start until the 3rd day of the power outage, and I'm pretty sure it had to do with me smoking a brisket in the backyard all night. Remember, I have a gas generator, so it's noisy. Now, let me paint a picture for you. This particular night, I go outside, my house is lit up, and up the road, my neighbor's house is lit up. There are clouds covering the moon, and we have absolutely no other sources of light, so it's freaking dark as hell. I'm walking up to my neighbor's house to carry him some vodka in exchange for some cigarettes. And the further I get away from the light of my house, the more unsafe I feel. Now you're naturally saying, fool, of course you feel unsafe. You're walking around at night in the dark. No, that's not true. I walk that road all the time headed to my neighbor's house. He walks the road coming to my house. And I can tell you, as long as I've been walking that road, I've never felt stalked like a predator was waiting on me or trying to eat me. But this time, it feels like something is out there in the tree line, even though I don't hear anything. I don't see anything. I can feel it. Now, back to the scene. I'm walking in the darkness to my neighbor's house. He's running a generator, has lights on at his property. If you're looking down on the situation from 30,000 feet in the air, I'm walking between basically 2 light sources. My eyes have now adjusted to the darkness, and I can see my neighbor's house with him standing out in the yard. Now, I take my eyes off of him for a split second and he's gone. Thinking he done went into the garage, I just keep walking. And again, I want to be clear with you. I don't hear anything, I don't see anything, I don't smell anything, no noises, no sounds. And about 40 yards away from the light that his house is generating, that's when I hear him say, George, George, get down on the ground. Huh? But looking around, I don't see him. George, trust me, get down on the ground, get down now. So I drop down to the ground and the next thing you know, blam, 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 blam. He's shooting right over my head. Now, if you've ever been hunting, you know what it sounds like when you shoot an animal, the sound of bullets hitting flesh? Well, I'm hearing that very, very close to me, combined with this groaning sound. Then he says, get up and run, run. Remember, I had that bottle of vodka in my hand when I hit the ground, it broke. So as I tried to get up and run, my feet slid on the glass. I start stumbling, sliding, my body twisting to the right. And that's when I see what he was shooting at. Listen, there's this bodybuilder that used to be out there. His name was Ronnie Coleman. The guy was a freak of nature. This was him with gray and black fur. And even in the dark, you can see the muscles under that hair. Giant pointy ears, this big old snout like a dog. And to this day, the most terrifying thing to me was how the light from the house picked up its eyes. It made them glisten this deep yellow and red. And I know, as I'm telling you right now, that I was scared and I could have been seeing things the wrong way, but it looked to me like the eyes themselves were yellow and the pupil was blood red. Look, after seeing that, my survival instincts kick in. Don't even remember how I got back to my feet. What I do remember is running and getting from the road to his yard, feeling like it was right behind me. Then I remember my neighbor stepping out from around the backside of his truck with his rifle and his son coming out of the house with the rifle as well, asking what's going on. Then this overwhelming sense of panic assaulting my brain because I realized I left my wife at home with the garage door open. And from there, things happen faster. The next thing you know, the two of you are running outside to his truck, getting in, riding back down to my house, only to scare the shit out of my wife because absolutely nothing was going on at the house. Listen, that night I was so afraid when my wife went to bed, I stayed up, turned the freaking generator off because I wanted to be able to hear. And I sat in my garage all night with the door partially open, in the dark, listening. And let me tell you, there was not a freaking sound coming from outside. Then, about 2:30 a.m., this freaking helicopter starts flying circles around the area in a search pattern. Now remember, I said I thought this encounter had to do with me smoking brisket. Get this, that helicopter is circling, so I decided to step out of the garage to see exactly what's going on. But I didn't want to stand out on the road or in the driveway, so I go into my gate, into my backyard. I'm walking along in the dark, my focus is up on the sky on this helicopter, and that's when I bump into my grill. It's knocked over into the middle of the freaking yard, 150 feet away from where it belongs. The majority of the brisket is gone, but there is still some brisket on the ground, and my grill is all fucked up. That helicopter makes another circle, then it's gone. So I stay woke the rest of that night, and then I go through the process of shifting my sleep pattern to where I'm awake at night and asleep in the day until the power is restored. Now, you would think that me and my neighbor talked about this incident a whole hell of a lot, but no, we didn't, because we didn't know what to make of it. But we talked about it one time, and he explained to me that that thing was following me. When I told him about the brisket, he figured it was following me because I was going to lead it to more food. I told him I totally disagree. I thought that I was the more food.